Hello, folks. I want to do a quick video on the beast that rises up out of the sea. It's an important beast because it's the beast, basically, that is a global empire before Jesus' return. Now, a lot of people think it's Europe, but it's not Europe, in my opinion. And again, these are my opinions, so enjoy. I think it's the United States of America and its military empire. The United States has over 1,000 military installations and over half of the nations on the planet. Now, it's important to keep in mind that the beasts the beast that Daniel was describing, for example, he worked for. He worked in the largest empire of his age thousands of years ago. He was a high-level ruler. And so he had a very organized mind in the sense that he was a project manager overseeing projects and those type of things. So the book of Daniel is about 6-7 pages long, but it's very organized. It starts out describing who he is and how he came to work in his empire into the position that was like third or fourth in his empire, and how he described that empire as a beast. So his full-time job was basically ruling and probably doing a lot of project management. But God had him. He practiced Judaism. He tried to keep the Old Testament instructions that God gave everyone on the earth, basically. And it was interesting because he would pray three times a day. He would bow toward Jerusalem, I think, and pray three times a day. And that was his time with God. And eventually, God gave him visions and dreams, and he documented some of them in the book of Daniel. And basically, from a ruler's perspective of an empire, what would a future empire look like over time? And so the first part of the book of Daniel describes several empires over time that would come up among the nations and have, you know, dominion. But in the book of Daniel chapter 7, one empire in particular is described in chapter 7 as coming up in four different stages, four beasts over time, one after another out of the sea. But that one is particularly special because it's in the same chapter. So the empire described in Daniel chapter 7 comes up before Jesus' return, which is very, very important to understand conceptually. So basically, I think that's the United States at four stages in the growth of its government over time. There are lots of other theories. Literally, there's 6 billion copies of the Book of Daniel in print, approximately, and billions and upon billions of people have tried to understand it over the millennium. But I think I've got a pretty good idea of what it's trying to communicate. And of course, I'm reading a translation, and you know, information is lost when it's transformed into another language. But I think I've still got a good approximation, and I want to share what I think it means for those. Well, I mean, it's important for everyone, but I think it's particularly important for those interested in the topic. Who's the beast that rises up out of the sea? And of course, like I said, that beast, or that is combined in, that is four beast in Daniel chapter 7 is combined into one beast in Revelation 13, as well as Revelation chapter 17 and 18. So right before Jesus' return in the book of Revelation as well. So both, it's doubly confirmed. And so it's confirmed in Daniel chapter 7, the four beasts that are combined into one in Revelation chapter 13 and 17 and 18. Because Revelation 17 and 18 occur right before Jesus' return, because like Revelation chapter 19, 20, 21, and 22 are pretty much describing the order of the future after Jesus returns. Like, how are things going to be structured in a very, very high level view of what reality will be like. Because basically, after Jesus returns, he recreates the earth. This earth has been polluted by mankind, is the rationale. And so he needs to recreate the earth so that mankind can live, potentially for eternity, at least those who eat of the tree of life. And it describes the tree of life that was in the Garden of Eden. Now it's in the New Jerusalem. Or will be, rather, when after Jesus comes back. And those who eat of it can potentially live for millions, billions, trillions of years. So very, very good thing if you can, if you have the right character, right? Because if you don't have the right heart, the right character, and you're living for millions, billions, trillions of years, you could really screw things up. Imagine, you know, like Hitler running around screwing up things, or Genghis Khan, or Stalin, you know, just devastating the countryside for millions, billions, trillions of years. It would be hell, right? So you have to have the right character, you have to have the right heart if you're going to dwell inside the New Jerusalem and have eternal life. And so that's one of the reasons why it's so very important to accept Jesus Christ as your Savior and believe on him, because when you do, that opens the door for the Holy Spirit to come in and get and teach you all things, as well as give you a new heart. And it, like, it's very important to do that. So I encourage you to do that if you haven't done that already. Accept Jesus Christ as your Savior. He is real. And in this video will also help prove that he's real. And help you, hopefully, if you need a little bit of help in your faith. You know, Thomas was one of the 12 disciples, and he still didn't believe until he stuck his finger in Jesus' nail scars. Because, you know, so don't be too hard on yourself if you're doubting. But the reality is, here's some proof that the Bible is materially true. Even though it's a translation, anyone can make their own translation and add whatever they want to it. And who's going to really, and if they're criticized by a few people out of billions, then, you know, how are you going to know? How are you going to know? So, but the reality is, even though there are hundreds of different translations and the nations, and even the Christian nations, you know, the 2 billion Christians, really can't be bothered to learn the original languages, the Hebrew and the Greek. And even if they did learn the original languages, there's still the fact that words change over time and their meaning and their usage, and there's cultural contexts that are lost and that type of thing over time. So, but doing the best we can with what we have, and there are a lot of great tools online now, and there's, like, Blue Letter Bible has a, you can actually look at the Greek, and you can get the Greek characters, and you can do word searches for more information on the Greek possible word meanings. So if you get stuck on something in the Bible, you can always go very quickly, in just minutes, you can research the actual root words. Whereas before, you know, that was just what, not possible. It really wasn't before the internet. So the internet can be used for more. I mean that's probably the best possible use of the internet is getting information about the Bible and how what God is actually talking about. And because, you know, obviously, if why wouldn't you follow the instructions of the Creator God? I mean, he created everything, you know, the trillions of cells in our bodies. He designed thousands of years ago, and they've been replicating and self-ordering thousands of years. Why wouldn't you take his instructions as if, you know, they're life? Because they are. But yeah, I mean, yeah, it's a words change, and so, you know, when we're really sure about something, maybe we shouldn't be so sure, and when we're not sure, maybe we should do some research and get some alternative possible meanings. But so Daniel chapter 7, it describes the United States at 4 stages in the growth of its government. That's the thesis of this video, and this video, the first beast that rises up out of the sea is the lion, with the eagle's wings. And so very readily, a lot of people recognize that, you know, the lion is a symbol of England, and the eagle's wings, the symbol, or the eagle is the symbol of the United States. And most people can make that connection. And the fact that the, you know, the eagle's wings are separated, that is the Revolutionary War in the United States, where the United States broke off from England and separated itself, became its own sovereign nation. And it was given the mind of a man. That was the nature of the sovereign nation. It wasn't another monarchy. It was a representative government. And the actual apportionment ratio is very important, because back then they wanted to set an apportionment ratio of about 35,000 citizens. But there was some argument. Some people wanted to set a ratio of 40,000 citizens. Now the point of that is, if there's 40,000 citizens per congressman, then, you know, you're talking about a localized area of a few miles in any kind of city environment, or even in the suburban environment. You know, it's a few miles radius. You could walk over or ride your horse over and talk to your representative most of the year. And you could know someone who knew your representative when there's just 40,000 representatives. Because you think about it, 40,000 citizens, or I mean 40,000 citizens to one representative, 40,000 citizens, you've got probably half to a quarter are children. So that makes it, let's say, 30,000. And then so half of those would be female. And the and then, of course, in the 1790s, women weren't permitted the right to vote. So that would leave about 15,000 males that could vote. But of those, only the landowning, in a lot of states, only the landowning males who had an economic stake in the economy, or the middle class rather, were permitted to vote. So you're looking at maybe 10,000 voters to one representative. And so you got a very small community. If people had ideas, if they were politically interested, they could either run for Congress themselves, or they could at least communicate their ideas readily one-on-one with, and get FaceTime with those representatives. Now the ratio is about 700,000 citizens, about 500,000 voters, because women have the right to vote, and children still do not have the right to vote. So about 700,000 citizens in the United States, including children, and then about 500,000 voters to one representative in Congress. So you've got a 50-fold decline in representation from the 1790s ratios. It's very important to understand that conceptually, because that is why most of the societal breakdowns occur. Why is it the water clean? You know, why isn't their drinking water clean, you know, in Flint, Michigan? Well, it's probably because they're not being represented in government. And so when you don't have that representation, there's all sorts of breakdowns. And there isn't as many people to provide oversight on issues, etc. And so with a ratio of 1 to 10,000 people, and again, those people were typically fairly intelligent, they grew up studying the Bible and the scriptures as their core reading material. And so they had, and if you imagine, you got the Creator God, right? And he's really smart, and he writes a book. Even if it's a translation, that book is going to alter the way people think and optimize it, as it were. And so you've got a lot of people who studied the scriptures over the millennium that have been very, very intelligent. And it's probably all by design, that there's actually a blessing inherent in the way that the words affect how people think, for those people that study the Bible. That I'm speculating, but and maybe I'm biased because I do like to study the Bible myself. I mean, it just seems logical. If God's going to write a book or have 60, six books written, you know, that's 6 billion copies over the ages. Pass all this information down through the line, you know, through the generations to this current generation, so that we could believe, you know. It's God making great efforts to reach this generation, but in a way that permits those who don't want to acknowledge it to be in denial. So hopefully you can get over that if you're in that situation, and realize that God is really he's reached out through time and space with 6 billion copies of the Bible, talking about current geopolitical events, and in such a way that past generations have thought that they were talking about current geopolitical events. I mean, so it's really genius from A to Z, the way that he's done this over time. It's very human. Anyway, so it's given the mind of man, that's representative government. They were able, you know, with the 10,000 to 1 ratio of voters to congressmen, to develop the Constitution and the Bill of Rights, and to come up with some very good advanced governmental mechanisms, policies, initially. And that, of course, that ratio has declined, and there's been lots of issues and breakdowns over the centuries since then. But I think that's what it means for the first beast that rises up out of the sea. So the second beast, it incorporates the first beast. It builds on it, and it grows. And, you know, so there's that history. There's the 13 colonies and their early forms of government and state governments, and then it expands all the way across the continent, 48 contiguous states. That's the second beast. So a lot of people associate the bear with Russia, and they do that because Russia has a population of about 140 so or so people, 140 million or so people, and but they have a ginormous land mass, and so it's very sparsely populated. In fact, in the geopolitical conceptual, just, you know, as a side note, like the Siberian and the far eastern provinces of, or states rather, of Russia, they have a land area about equal to the size of China, but they only have like a few million people in those Siberian and far eastern provinces, and they're directly north of China. Of course, China has about 1.4 billion people, 1.4 billion people or so. And so that is a huge geopolitical issue for Russia, is they've got this sparsely populated area out in the middle of, you know, half their nation. And then they have this huge, highly populated, and it's becoming ever more technically advanced China on their southern border. And that's putting a lot of pressure on Russia. Of course, China wants to continue to expand its internal development, and to do that they need to look outside of their national borders for resources, and of course Russia has those resources. So a lot of tension along that border, and there has been for a long time, as long as Russia and China have existed, which is a long time. They've had that relationship where there's been a need for Russia to maintain an advanced and strong military, technologically superior, as much as possible, so that they can hold on to their provinces north of China. China could easily expand and colonize Siberia and the Far East province and develop all those natural resources and be twice as powerful as it is now overnight if it was inclined to. But China is focused on China, and the Chinese people are very focused on their own race, as it were, and their own cultures. But that is changing. You know, they are looking outward for development of resources throughout the earth. And they are building, they're building up Africa, they're building up the infrastructure so to transport goods, rail and roads in throughout Africa, for example. dams, they're financing dams. So they're taking the trade surplus that they're getting from the United States. And again, they're getting a trade surplus from the United States because of the government's, U.S. government's policies toward China. And so you've got representative government in the form of 435 representatives. And if they were at 1790s levels of representation, there'd be about 21,000 representatives in the House of Representatives. So you can imagine with 21,000 representatives, China wouldn't be getting away with anything. With all those representatives, some of them would be economically interested. And that's a neat thing about having lots of people with their various interests and passions. They would be able to pursue those and develop good policy in those areas in particular. And so a lot of those people would be, you know, watching China very closely as the largest trading nation, one of the largest trading nations with the United States, and looking at each of their actions and each of their industries. And you would get a lot of a lot more mitigation in the imbalances of trade with China if there was more representatives to provide oversight. That's what I'm trying to say, I guess. But yeah, I mean, they've minimized it. And again, the reason for minimizing it, of course, is to empower the special interests so that they can influence a smaller group of congressmen to do their whatever policies they want to do, whatever tenets that they have, the special interests, rather than the interests of the people. That's why, of course, they have fewer representatives over time. It's not because they're too cheap to increase the size of the buildings to house people. They could readily, I mean, they spend trillions of dollars in the United States government every year. You could very easily build a large building for all the congressmen and representatives to meet in and have meeting rooms and all that good stuff. It wouldn't not be a big problem, and you would get much better quality of policy. I mean, if you think about it, like the American Affordable Health Care Act, it was a 1,000-page bill. And they received it, Congress received it a day before they voted on it. There was absolutely no way that any of them had a chance to read the Affordable Health Care Act before they voted on it. And so, you know, that act pretty much gave Congress, or the government rather, control of about 18% of the U.S. economy at a time that was in a, you know, depression, recession. And they hadn't even read the bill, and they were voting, okay, yeah, we're, you know, the economy's already screwed up, so they just, you know, they went ahead and approved a bill that they hadn't read on 18% of the economy. Sort of bizarro, doesn't make much sense to me, except for there are special interests, and they're pushing agendas, and they're able to influence a smaller group of people a lot more readily than they could a larger group. So if there's 21,000 representatives, like 1790s ratios, you would have had a lot more people standing up, say, hey, you know what, I want to read this bill before I vote on it, you know, and especially if it's something that important. And why is it 1,000 pages? Well, why? You know, what's being buried in there? You know, so there's a lot of issues with the mind of a man, as it were, in the first beast. But so the second beast, again, I went all the way around the world. I went to Russia and China and then back around to the United States. But the second beast is the wilderness area of the United States being settled by the Europeans. So back in the 1800s, the United States spread across the continent, and it, you know, founded the 48 contiguous states of the United States, and that was a huge increase in the size of government and the growth of government of the United States. And of course, there's the Supreme Court as well that was established and got going. And so the expanding across the vast expanses of the North America, the continental North America, that was full of bears. So the same reason that people think that Russia is the bear is the same reason why they should think that North America is also the bear. Because it was wilderness areas, you know, and these beasts are coming up one after another out of the sea. So Russia really doesn't come up out of the sea, so there's another point to consider. They do have an Arctic coastal region that's very long, but they don't really have a Pacific, well, they do have Pacific, but they don't really have an Atlantic or a Mediterranean, or they don't have a lot of, whereas the United States has got, you know, these two giant, and then the Gulf of Mexico as well, there's lots of coastal area. So that's, you know, that's why a lot of people think that the beast that rises up out of the sea is Europe, and it's got something to do with Rome or whatever. But that's not what it is. Now the three ribs. So this is important because I already talked about Daniel being a high level ruler in the largest empire on the earth in his time. And as a ruler in that empire, he understood that, you know, for commerce to occur, they needed roads, but they also needed navigable rivers. And those navigable rivers were the super highways of the ancient world, because they could really transport goods cheaply and cost effectively. I mean, just very inexpensively to transport goods in bulk from one city to another if there was a river that was navigable. And so the Ohio, Mississippi, and Missouri rivers are navigable rivers that have enabled the United States to reach deep into the interior of the United States to develop resources, to have farms, and bring that food back down to the population centers, as well as other resources, wood, timber, you know, coal, all kinds of resources go up and down Mississippi, and they still do today. So those would be the three ribs. Now the actual Hebrew, if you look at the Hebrew, it can mean like a waterway for the word rib. So it was just a translation issue, and that happens, you know, because translators are just people. Anyone can make their own translation. And arising and eating much flesh. And of course, this is the transition from the third beast, or no, from the second beast, the bear, to the leopard. And it says, arise and eat much flesh. And so bears, you know, and they that's probably why they picked ribs, right, instead of waterways, because it referred to eating flesh. And so it was thinking, bear is eating flesh, it must have, you know, what kind of flesh do bears eat? Well, there's some ribs, instead of waterways. But those are actually a reference to the many wars that the United States has engaged in, like the Civil War in the 1800s, the World War I and World War II. And that really transitions into the third beast, which is the leopard. Excuse me, I got a cold. So the third beast that is a leopard, that has spots. Now the spots, I believe, are the, well, first let me just say what I think the third beast is. I think it's the establishment of a standing army after World War II. And after World War II, the United States, because before World War II, like World War I, the Civil War, any of the wars, 1812, whatever, Revolutionary War, every war that the United States engaged in, it always, it recruited a bunch of people to go fight in the war, and then they would, after the war was over, they would stand down. They'd return to their normal civilian lives. They didn't maintain a standing army. There was like a small force of a few thousand men that would, you know, a corps, like an officer corps type situation, but they would not otherwise maintain a large army. And there was no reason to. There was no real enemies. And even today, you know, it's the United States is a regional power in the sense that it doesn't have any strong enemies on its borders. You know, Mexico and Canada are not really hostile nations to the United States at all. So, whereas in Europe, you know, it's just constant war between various nations throughout Europe in the last several thousand years. You know, all the kingdoms and their basically warlords just trying to expand their influence in their in Europe. But so what happened after World War II is the United States decided to maintain a standing army. You know, the United States had been dragged over there in World War I, as it were, and then again in World War II. And so rather than leave entirely and stand down, the United States left a lot of assets, infrastructure, started developing infrastructure and helping to rebuild as well Europe and the various nations that have been destroyed. But it set up military bases and kept them in Europe and also in Asia. And kept military presence in those nations. You know, even today, 70 years later, there's still U.S. military bases operating in Germany. And so, usually throughout history, if a nation houses another nation's military, they're actually a vassal state. And so there's a lot of nations that could be said to be economic vassal states throughout the earth, because they are, in a sense, paying the United States a form of tribute by using the U.S. dollar for international trade, as well as they go along with American policies and agendas in a lot of nations, especially if they have U.S. military presence there, because that is a huge economic impact on their economy, and it also is a stabilizing influence. Having the United States military in, like, Germany has kept Germany from, you know, another world war for the last 70 years. And again, Germany, you know, they had World War I, they had the Franco-Prussian War, they had World War I, they had World War II, and very likely would have had World War III and IV by now if the United States had stood down. And so there's rationale for why things are the way they are. So the United States has actually spent about 600 billion man hours in 2,000 hours a year per troop in Europe over the last 70 years. That's a huge investment the United States has made in Europe. Europe has therefore been able to have a minimal military developed throughout their nations. I think Germany, for example, only has about 400 tanks, while the United States is maintaining a force of about 5,000 tanks. And they're able to do that because they're not concerned about someone attacking them. And of course, there's the U.S. policies that they're also supporting quite often in Germany. But the, you know, the same is true of other nations, Italy and so it's not an armed camp. Like, Europe used to be an armed camp for hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years. They were making war on each other continuously. And so by having a U.S. presence there, they've been able to take those resources, rebuild their societies, and have a higher standard of living. And some can make this argument that the European standard of living is higher than the United States. If you take one metric, which would be high-speed rail, they actually have like several thousand kilometers of high-speed rail. The United States doesn't have any high-speed rail. Similarly, in Japan, you know, they have a lot of high-speed rail, and China has about twice as much high-speed rail as Europe does, because you know, they've really been developing their economy internally, and again, the United States has zero. You know, there's another metric that I just can't, a geopolitical metric about China. They're graduating about 600,000 engineers each year. Those engineers, they go build buildings, they build roads, they build bridges. They come up with new product ideas. You know, they're growing. Whereas the United States is I would say they're stagnating, but they're not. They're actually really falling behind in most aspects of engineering, which is the core, right, of a civilization. Being able to build roads, infrastructure, and design products is kind of important. It's like the United States is probably, well, they're graduating about 120,000 engineers at the universities in the United States, but about only about 20,000, 15 to 20,000 of them are actually American citizens. The rest of them are foreign nationals from China and India and other nations around the world that are coming, and they're taking up the seats at the universities. And the universities are happy to have, well, they're basically educating foreigners to build up their countries instead of building up the United States. And I'm sure that if that was part of policy, and again, this goes back to that apportionment level, because you don't have as many representatives providing oversight, they're not encouraging universities to stimulate the number of American engineers. And so, you know, here's China's producing 600,000 engineers per year. They go off, and for the rest of their life, they're doing engineering stuff. And the United States is producing 15 to 20,000. So you got a 30-fold increase in China. And the same is true in India. India's producing about 600,000 engineers as well. So not a really sustainable... I mean, it's really like they are just totally not really planning on building anything in the United States as a society. Because you need engineers, and unless you want to have a whole bunch of foreigners come and build stuff, like I heard China's building a railroad car plant for building railroad cars. Well, they're sending their engineers to the United States to design the cars and then using American labor force. But again, the growth of, or the transition, you know, those intellectual jobs are very important to a nation's ability to defend itself in times of war, because you need to have the know-how to produce the weapon systems. So as a form of national security, not developing the educational infrastructure in the United States is a huge, huge, huge long-term issue for the United States, because it takes time to train people. And it's just not happening in the United States. So they'd rather train foreigners, apparently, at the universities. And again, the government's not stepping in to encourage people to go into... apparently, I mean, not materially, because it's not happening. You know, scholarships for engineering or whatever. And, you know, it's so important, and it's not happening. So, yeah, the third beast is the leopard. It has four heads. So, after World War II, the Standing Army of the United States, their four heads, the Joint Chiefs of Staff, and those men are generals, admirals, over the vast military-industrial complex. It has millions upon millions of people in troops and support staff and contractors, and then in suppliers, manufacturers, and they're over that. So it's a huge growth in government. And the third beast is given dominion. That it is military dominion, and again, the United States has over 1,000 military installations and over half the nations on the planet. If a nation's large enough to house a U.S. military base or a military installation, it probably has one. And of course, the U.S. budget for the military has just been absurd. It's been really super expensive. And that actually goes toward the Revelation 13. Revelation 13 indicates the beast that rises up out of the sea. It has all the attributes of the four beasts that rise up out of the sea in Daniel chapter 7 combined into one beast, because it is one beast that is one nation, it's one people. And it describes them as being a military superpower. It says, who can make war on the beast? And again, a lot of other nations, you know, they're not, you know, Libya's not really a threat. You know, 4 million people in Libya, and yet the U.S. went in and launched, you know, a strike against Libya, overthrew the government, destabilized it, of Libya. But again, you know, Syria, Afghanistan, Iraq, Afghanistan and Iraq, for example, the United States spent about $6 trillion since the initiation of hostilities with those nations. And those $6 trillion, that's a lot of money, folks, because someone's paying for that eventually, right? You've got about 125 million households in the United States. And if you divide that by $6 trillion, you get about $150,000 per family in the United States in debt just for the Iraq and Afghanistan war. Now, the Afghanistan war, Afghanistan is the poorest nation on the planet. Why in the world did the United States spend $150,000 per family to wage a war on Afghanistan? Was it at all necessary? Does that make any sense? And to wage a war on Iraq? Iraq didn't do anything. Because they might possibly do something someday, that's now justification for war. Same thing with North Korea. Now, North Korea, you know, they are saying, they are verbal, you know, they are threatening a nuclear holocaust. So their rhetoric could justify war. But at the same time, who's benefiting from these wars? And I think you'll find that it's the, excuse me, it's the Antichrist, false prophet, Rothschilds that are benefiting. Their central banks in every nation on the planet are the ones that are holding the debt and issuing the debt at interest. So it's not just $150,000, it's $150,000 plus interest over time. And it's absurd. Why, you know, who benefits? So there you go. So yeah, the United States has dominion, and the four wings are, would be the four winds of the earth. The leopard spots, I think, are the military installations around the world. Now, in Revelation chapter 13, this is what I wanted to point out, was that vast expense, right? $150,000 in debt per family in the United States for the Iraq and Afghanistan wars, enriching the Rothschilds bank, the Antichrist false prophet Rothschilds, central banking system, which they own and control the central banks in most of the nations on the earth. Most all of them, like North Korea, Iran, I think Syria wasn't, but maybe they were. But there's only a handful, only a couple, that aren't Rothschild owned controlled banks. And so this family, the foreigners, right, because they're not Americans for the most part, are given the legal license to print money in the United States and control the money supply and control the currency and all that stuff. Does that make any sense to anyone? And so the amount of influence that special interest has over the economy is huge. No one's ever audited the Fed. The you know, it's called the Fed, but it's not federal. I mean, it's not part of the government, of the United States government, as it were. They actually have no oversight, really. The Congress has no oversight. They haven't audited it. I mean, they have, like, a committee where they answer questions, and I think they get to appoint one person on the board of directors of the Fed, but that's it. It's more of a token acknowledgement of sovereignty in the United States being with the United States government, because they have not audited the Fed. It's the most influential organization in the United States, and they have never audited it. As far as I know, they don't pay any taxes on their income, so they're just they're above the law, basically. And so that's a, you know, that's a huge issue. And so someone, you know, someday hopefully we'll deal with that, because it's absurd. It doesn't make any sense for the Federal Reserve to be, or the central bank to be, privately owned by foreigners and controlled by foreigners that are wielding huge influence over the United States and then impoverishing America, basically. I mean, 9 out of 10 people in the United States don't own the homes that they live in the biblical sense, you know. 100 years ago, people owned the homes that they lived in, for the most part. And today, virtually 9 out of 10, 90% do not own the homes in the biblical sense. Free of property taxes, or free of a mortgage, threatening to take their homes from them. At least periodically threatening them. And so that's a huge, huge difference. And so what's behind all that? It's that privately owned central banking system that has inflated the housing market and the prices over time. And so, yeah, it's a big deal. It's a very big deal. So the fourth beast. So the fourth beast is, it has 7 heads. So these beasts are coming up over out of the sea out of over time. Excuse me. And the fourth beast. Actually, I'm going to stop right here for a second. Okay, so the fourth beast. It has 7 heads. Now, those 7 heads, just like the 4 heads, so the 4 heads after World War II, the Joint Chiefs had 4 men that were in charge of the vast military-industrial complex. Well, now, today, 2017, there are 7 men that are over the vast, there are 7 heads over the vast military-industrial complex. There are 7 Joint Chiefs today. And so, that leaves the 10 horns. So what are the 10 horns, then? Well, the 10 horns are... it's kind of interesting because in the 1970s, they established the 10 administrative regions of the United States. And those have grown in power. And so, you know, it's consistent with this narrative of growth in government. You know, that these 4 beasts are 4 stages in the growth of government over time. And so I don't think that the fourth beast has begun yet, because it basically has... it has authority for 3.5 years to trample down the earth. Now, the United States has been trampling down the earth, you know, the whole Middle East, pretty much, you know, Iraq, Afghanistan, Syria, Ukraine, Libya, Yemen. And you could argue Sudan, Pakistan as well. But I don't think that fourth beast has really begun yet in earnest. I could be wrong. But I don't think it has. The issue is, and it should be fairly obvious, because I believe the 10 horns are, you know, those 10 administrative regions. And in 2010, at the beginning of the year, by executive order, a council of 10 governors, so there would be 10 men. And this is consistent with Revelation chapter 17 and 18, where 10 men give their authority to the beast. And then they basically authorize military strikes on Jerusalem. Maybe not directly. Maybe it's military strikes against those people invading Jerusalem would be a better way of stating it. Because... the U.S. is, by treaty, is obligated to defend Israel in the event of war. Now, this is a very significant difference. In the past, the United States really wasn't obligated to defend Israel. We might send supplies, weapons, systems, that type of thing in the event of war, but we're talking about U.S. engagement, troops, aircraft, defending Israel in a time of war. And that is by treaty what they've done. They basically said, they made it so that the U.S. is obligated to defend modern state of Israel in a time of war. And yeah, you know, it may deter war because, again, the rest of the nations are like, who can make war on the United States? And that's consistent with Revelation chapter 13. Oh, you know, the other part that was consistent with Revelation chapter 13, and I meant to mention this, was the debt. So the United States spent $6 trillion on Iraq and Afghanistan war. Well, that's the wound by the sword. You know, it's the expenditure on the military-industrial complex that is wounding America. Because instead of developing America's infrastructure, improving the quality of life for Americans, making sure Flint, Michigan has potable drinking water, those type of things, the United States government is instead pushing an agenda around the world that doesn't really benefit the American people more than having, you know, clean drinking water. So they're choosing to empower the sword, the military-industrial complex, rather than representing the more direct immediate needs of the American people. There's something like 2.5 million children that are homeless in America each year, and they could have homes for a small fraction of what the United States is spending on the military. Similarly, there are about 7 million people that die of starvation on the earth each year, and for about $30 billion a year, all of those people's lives could be saved, as well as from death by starvation, as well as, you know, hunger could be ended on the earth for about $30 billion a year. So for the cost of NASA, they could end hunger on the earth. And since 9/11, they would have saved about over 100 million people's lives from death by starvation if they had chosen to end hunger on the earth. And what would help America's national security interests more? Building up some goodwill with the rest of the nations on the planet by ending hunger on the planet, or you know, trampling down the Middle East, which is what, you know, or just invading Iraq and Afghanistan, you know, for and spending $6 trillion, enriching the Antichrist, false prophet Rothschilds at the expense of everyone else. So that's what I think the sword is basically the wound by the sword is the expense of the sword. And so it's consuming America, this war footing. You look at North Korea, and they spend most of their money on their military so that they could prop up their government, because they're afraid of, you know, South Korea or China or whatever. So rather than feed their people and focus on that, focus on education, developing a healthy society, they're focused on building, you know, 1960s era tanks and weapon systems. But yeah, so so the 10 horns. So like I said, in 2010 they established a council of 10 governors over the United States, and basically it's for continuity of government. So if there's ever a war or a economic crisis, and, you know, which those powerful economic interests that have been the Antichrist, false prophet, Rothschilds have been given the given license. It's like they won the lottery, and they're foreigners, but they won the lottery. They've been given the right to print money virtually, and controlling and owning the central banks in basically every nation on the earth. And that's also consistent with the narrative of Revelation chapter 13, where it says an image would be set up and worshipped around the world. Well, you've got the Antichrist, false prophet, Rothschild's currencies being worshipped around the world by virtually everyone on the planet. And that's idolatry. And greed is idolatry. And that's a big deal if you want to have eternal life in Jesus Christ. So here's, you know, I'm just sharing my thoughts. There's a lot to think about. And hopefully this is helpful. But I think that there's going to be a 3.5 year period. It may correlate with the fifth trumpet, which is 5 months of rioting. That's in Revelation chapter 9. The fifth time. So the Revelation's outlined by seals, trumpets, bulls, and that's like a long timeline of contiguous events. So all the seals happen, and then the trumpets start happening, then the bulls start happening. And in between those chapters, they have other chapters that are basically subsets of detailed information that occurred during the during that segment of a timeline. That is, you know, like, so Revelation chapter 6 is followed by chapter 7, and that would be something that happened during the seals. And Revelation chapter 8 and 9 are the trumpets, and Revelation chapter 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, and 15 are detailed subsets of things that happen during the trumpets, so during the timeline. So you get a long timeline, and then you get detailed bits of information about particular topics in the subsets of chapter. And the book of Daniel's laid out in the same design, because, you know, Daniel actually makes more sense with Daniel, because Daniel was a high-level ruler. He understood project management and timelines and event chains and that type of thing. You know, XYZ needs to happen before, you know, the next thing happens. You have to build the foundation before you can build the walls, before you can build the roof, that sort of thing. Okay, so then there's fire, right? And in Daniel chapter 7, there's fire. And so that could be a nuclear war. And again, the United States, the U.S. military administration just attacked, without a declaration of war, attacked a Russian military base in Syria. And so what's going on in Syria, if you haven't noticed, is a GOG MAGOG war. It's outlined in chapter 38 and 39 of Ezekiel. Ezekiel 38 and Ezekiel 39 are the GOG MAGOG war. There's actually another GOG MAGOG war that's described in Revelation after Jesus comes back. But the word GOG MAGOG just means distant land, or, well, MAGOG means distant land, or distant peoples, that type of thing. And so in Ezekiel, a lot of people assume that Magog is Russia, because it's in the same line as Meshach and Tubal, which is an obvious reference to Russia. But it could be that it's talking about two different nations. And so if the United States gets a whole bunch of troops involved in Syria, that's not good, because that means the United States is getting involved in the Gog Magog war. It's really not a good thing for the United States. And obviously, it's not a good thing for Russia to be involved in the Gog Magog war either. And so really, you know, it's a big deal when anyone touches the apple of God's eye. So just for reference, Syria is composed of lands that were a part of ancient northern Israel, in a geopolitical sense and historically. So the people in Syria would be descendants of ancient Israel. And similarly, the people in Israel are actually, some of them are descendants of Judah. Well, quite a few, most actually, would be descendants of Judah. And so after Solomon, so under King Solomon, Israel expanded to its largest geographical area all the way up through Syria. But after Solomon, it split into two nations, a northern kingdom and a southern kingdom. So the southern kingdom was called Judah, with the capital of Jerusalem, and that would be modern-day Israel, for the most part. And then the northern kingdom would have been Israel. So yeah, when it says all of those combatants, so Persia, Iran, which is Iran, Turkey is Gomer and Togarma, and Turkey has invaded Syria as well. There's rebel fighters that have been recruited, because most of the rebels are actually mercenaries being paid by various intelligence agencies. And again, it all kind of, yeah, it's not good. So, but you've got rebels from Libya and Sudan, which would be Ethiopia, so, because Ethiopia used to be larger, encompassing the territory of Sudan. But you've got rebels fighting in Syria, that have been recruited, from those nations. So all of the nations outlined in Ezekiel 38 have been are being represented in Syria. And the big question is, who is Magog? Is it Russia? But yeah, it's not good to touch the apple of God's eye, and I don't think the United States should be meddling in the Middle East, especially in Syria and Israel. And again, What provoked the Lord to jealousy in Ezekiel chapter 22, I think it is, the Lord refers to Israel, and especially in particular Jerusalem, as a whore, a prostitute, because the people of Jerusalem were relying on the beasts of those their day, thousands of years ago. They were relying on alliances with other nations. They're supposed to be relying on the Lord. And so he's a jealous God. And so when Egypt makes an alliance with Israel, or Assyria, or Babylon, or so it's basically provoking the Lord to jealousy, and the United States should know better than to touch the apple of the Lord's eye. That is, you know, it's not on the United States to get in between God and Israel and try and protect Israel. That is the Lord's job. He views Jerusalem as his wife, and so, you know, it doesn't make much sense for some guy to come from halfway around the world to defend the Lord's wife. The Lord will defend his wife. And, you know, getting in a domestic dispute with the Creator God is not a good idea. This is a narrative that's consistent with both the Syrian civil war, Ezekiel 38 and Ezekiel 39, and Daniel chapter 7. And Daniel chapter 7 indicates that there'd be fire. And so, yeah, it could be a nuclear war. And again, the United States just attacked a Russian military base without a declaration of war issued by Congress. It's just administration just totally disregarding the Constitution of the United States, which indicates that only Congress has the authority to declare war, initiate hostilities with another nation. And the United States attacked Russia. So that's a very big deal. It's absurd. Bizarre world, but that's what happened. But the point, and it could result in a nuclear war, and there could be a nuclear war, but I don't think so. I mean, eventually, maybe, but Revelation chapter 9 indicates that people don't repent, even after the 5 months of rioting, in the fifth trumpet, where the locusts are riot police, and even after the 200 million man sixth trumpet war begins, people don't repent. And similarly, in Revelation chapter 16, even by the time of the bulls, when the whole sea dies, and I think that sea is the Pacific Ocean, when all the creatures in the Pacific Ocean die, people are still not repenting. They don't know, because their media is controlled. There's like five corporations that control 90% of the media. And so they might talk about it every once in a while. They give it a token, that they could say that they talked about it. But really, if the whole Pacific Ocean is dying because it's man-made idiotic, you know, retardation, basically, putting 50 nuclear power reactors on a volcanic tsunami, typhoon, volcanically active island chain, I mean, that's just complete retardation by mankind. And they did it because they're afraid, because they wanted to be able to make nuclear weapons in Japan. It's just retarded. Nobody wants your islands, Japan. Really, nobody wants to invade your islands. Seriously, nobody cares. You shouldn't have destroyed the Pacific Ocean. But you know, it's not just Japan, right? Because all the nations have been dumping toxic waste in the Pacific Ocean. And, you know, those barrels, they rust out, and then there's a big earthquake on March 11, 2011. And those barrels are all, you know, they're rusting, and they release a whole bunch more toxic waste. So it's not just Japan. But Japan is the most obvious and noteworthy geopolitically, and it's described in the Bible. In the sixth trumpet, it's the word mountain moved can mean like an island. And it actually says islands. And so you've got an island chain in Japan that's on fire with fallout. Of course, God knows what fallout is. He designed reality, so he knows how radiation works. The question is, do most people? And no, most people don't understand how radiation works. But yeah, it's tasteless. You can't see it, and it's odorless, and it's burning on the atomic level. But yeah, it's burning. And so, on the same day that the Syrian civil war began, and Ezekiel 38 says, basically something to the effect that, you know, when you come up against against the mountains of northern Israel, which would be Syria, that his anger would be kindled and he'd send a great earthquake. And there was a great earthquake on that same day, or no, a couple days earlier. So when they started coming up, we probably, you know, there was some staging, whatever. 3/15/2011, there was a great earthquake. No, 3/11/2011, there was a great earthquake. But on the same day that the Syrian conflict began, 3/15/2011, so that same week, fire in the form of atmospheric fallout from Japan began to reach North America. And it's just been burning on a continuous basis. Bob Nichols is a Veterans Today. He does an analysis of radiation monitors from the EPA. And he's indicating just thousands of times a multiple over background. So like normally it's only supposed to be 5 to 20 counts per minute. And he's saying there's like thousands, like literally 2,000 times that, you know, maybe like 2, 3, 4, 5, 6,000 counts per minute. But you can't taste, touch, or smell it. It just degrades the quality of life over time. And there's references throughout the Bible to that degradation. I can't remember the chapter, but... or which book it was, but it says something to the effect, weep and wail, you rich people, the wages you failed to pay your laborers, they're crying out to the Lord, and your gold and your silver are corroded or corrupted, and will testify against you, and consume your flesh, consume your garments, which is basically the flesh, with fire. And in Zechariah 5, it talks about, this is wickedness, which is basically nuclear energy, which is man-made fallout, and how it enters into the house of the thief and the liar and consumes it from the inside. And I think it's a reference to the consuming people's bodies with fallout. So, I mean, it's pervasive throughout the Bible, the theme. And so there's fire in Daniel chapter 7 as well. That consumes the beasts over time. And it's over time. You know, there's this narrative that everything happens in 7 years. And so everyone's expecting all of the events in Revelation to happen in 7 years. Well, it's not really rational for that because it doesn't actually say that everything happens in 7 years anywhere in the Bible. It's just something that's been propagated. And they say it, you know, these pastors. And you don't even know. Some of these pastors might be working for... the devil, as it were, not really trying to figure things out, but they're just propagating, they may just be propagating misinformation from disinfo agents, as it were. Either way, I mean, everybody, I think there was a time when I believed in a 7 year, because I had heard it over and over again, over decades. You know, there's going to be a seven-year trib. And it's like every chance they get, they say that. And it's nowhere in the Bible does it say there's going to be a seven-year trib. And in fact, Revelation chapter 11 indicates it's going to be longer because it talks about a seven-year period. 42 months at 1,260 days. But that's just one chapter. So it stands to reason, you know, all the stuff before Revelation 11 and all the stuff after it takes longer. And the reality is, if all the events in Revelation happened in 7 years, wouldn't people repent? If it was that traumatic and ongoing? No, it happens more gradually than that, and that's how people are being deceived into not repenting and turning away from their sins. Because they're not getting this narrative that this things happen over time. You know, the fire, you can't taste, touch, or smell it. Who's going to think of that? You know, who's going to make that connection? But yeah, that's I mean, Zechariah 5 actually describes a missile weapon system. It's got a roll that flies, and it delivers a, you know, something that consumes, burns up stones and timbers. Well, that's a weapon system. Michael Rood did an analysis of Zechariah 5 that was pretty decent, I think. There's actually even more information there if you look at the Hebrew. And it looks like the second part of Zechariah 5 might be talking about cruise missiles, because it's got the wings of the stork. But, yeah, I mean, it's worth looking at. Again, it's translation, and most of the translation, you know, the primary translations for the English language were made about 500 years ago. And so they've just been making variations on that, rather than innovate and say what it actually might be in modern scientific terms. But, you know, they're making a product they're trying to sell to people. And if it, I guess if it's too different, that would be difficult. But then they have agendas as well, right? Because you're... Everyone has agendas, right? Well, my agenda is to try and help as many people, you know, begin that relationship with God. Because only the Holy Spirit, it's only by the Holy Spirit that anyone can be saved. But... first step is, you know, acknowledging that Jesus Christ is real and believing in Him, accepting His sacrifice for our sins, His faithfulness, and accepting Him as Lord and Savior. And so I hope that you will all take the time to do that. And if you do, remember to listen to your heart. Listen to the Holy Spirit speak to your heart. Because that is, He'll save you so much trouble in your lives if you do that. I know you know, listening to Him is the about the best thing that you can do in your lives. And again, He's there for as long as you are, the Holy Spirit. He's a counselor, He's God, and it's important to treat Him appropriately, as if He is God, because He is God, and He will come and dwell in people. Yeah, it's anything's possible for those who believe in Jesus Christ. Literally, anything is possible. Because it's God comes and lives inside you, and counsels you. And you begin a relationship with God the Father, with Jesus Christ. I mean, obviously Jesus is one person. He'll be ruling the New Jerusalem for eternity. So He's going to be kind of busy. A lot of people have this idea that, you know, they're going to be hanging out with Jesus. Well, there's going to be like 100 billion people resurrected after the resurrection. And Jesus is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. So He's going to be kind of busy. And so, you know, actual FaceTime with Jesus is probably going to be fairly rare. But the Holy Spirit, because of His nature being a spirit, He's able to, and He actually, I think, may be the breath of life, which the Lord breathed into Adam in the garden. And so when we have a relationship with Him, we can have a larger portion of Him in our lives. And, you know, Jesus said, if you knew who it was who was speaking with you, you would have asked and for living water. And I think, you know, like Elisha, he asked for a double portion of Elijah's spirit. And so I think it's possible to have a more full relationship with the Holy Spirit. You know what I mean? Like a larger portion of the Holy Spirit in our lives. And that's good. I mean, that's life on the earth and the divine inside of man, you know, inside of mankind. We were created to have relationship with the Creator God, and really it's through the Holy Spirit that we have that relationship. So listen to the Holy Spirit. Repent of your sins, believe in Jesus Christ, and listen to the Holy Spirit. Study the scriptures. These are all great things to do. And potentially, you could enter in and eat of the tree of life and live for millions, billions, trillions of years. It really is regardless of how, you know, it's kind of irritating to a lot of people the idea that Hitler, right, or Stalin could potentially repent of their sins and have eternal life. But the reality is that's how it works. If you're a righteous person and you turn away from righteousness and you do wickedly, that's not good. But if you're a wicked person and you turn away from your wickedness, turn to righteousness, then you might possibly have eternal life in Jesus Christ someday after the resurrections. Anyway, so the point I was trying to make about the fire is that, yeah, the same day Syrian civil war began, Ezekiel 39 verse 6 says, I will send fire on those who live in safety in the coastlands, so that would be the United States, and on Magog. And so the question is, who's Magog? Is Magog Russia, or is it the United States? Because then it's really saying people who live in safety in the coastlands, and Magog, well, anyway. So the fire's fallout, the fallout's already been sent, and it's burning. Pacific Ocean, they're closing the fisheries along the west coast of America. And over time, you know, it's accumulating all this man-made pollution. And it's for that reason that God needs to come back and recreate the earth, because mankind's destroying the earth over time. You know, they've built all these nuclear power plants, and it's happening gradually. And that's just one vector of pollution, but it's a huge vector. But yeah, mankind's devastating the earth. And it's not the individuals, it's not people with their hairspray, CFC cans of hairspray. No, it's corporations enriching a few people, enriching the Antichrist, false prophet, Rothschilds at everyone else's expense. You know, just ginormous corporations polluting, doing whatever they can to cut corners so that they can, it's for currency, and it's a form of idol worship. It's a form of greed. And there's one other thing that I should talk about in this, and that is China and India. So in Revelation chapter 13, it talks about the mark of the beast. And so what's happened is you've got the Antichrist, false prophet, Rothschilds, and their worshippers, basically like the Bilderbergs, all these economic influential groups that worship money, basically are pushing for societies to implement national ID card programs. And if you have a national ID card program, well, you really need to look at that and consider, is that the mark of the beast, or a mark of the beast, or is it offensive to the Creator God? Because Revelation chapter 14 indicates that it's a big deal. And here's some thoughts on why that's a big deal. When Jesus returns and he recreates the earth and he resurrects people, those who overcome will be given new names written on white stones. And, you know, that's kind of interesting conceptually, because a stone can last for, you know, millions, billions, trillions of years, and who knows how long a stone could last. So as an ID token, a stone, you know, could last for a long time. But the point is, the government of heaven is giving those people who get to enter into the kingdom of heaven a new name. And so when China, for example, issues a national identity card, and they've issued 1 billion national identity cards in China, and on that it has a citizen identity number, which is basically a number for a citizen, so it's for identification purposes, so it's a name that is a number for a citizen on a mark, an identification card. Marks in the ancient world, so over the thousands of years in the past, they'd allow a servant or a slave to conduct business on the part of their masters, like a seal or signet or a mark, basically just some kind of referential integrity mechanism for communicating that they had authority to conduct business. Similarly, in China, they have mandatory, 1 billion cards have been issued to 1 billion people, and they have those those numbers as names, and if you, it's an 18-digit number, and so it says in Revelation chapter 13, if you count the number of the beast, if it is the number of a man, it is 666. So 6 plus 6 plus 6 is an 18-digit number, is what they forced a billion people in China to receive. Everyone 16 years old and older. And so it's important that they repent, right? Unfortunately, most of China is just completely ignorant, godless heathens, as it were. They're very materialistic in that sense, but there's only about 3% that have any kind of nominal belief in Jesus Christ in China. But that's still a lot of people, 3%. And each year at the age of 16, people are enrolling in those national identity card programs because that's when they're required to get them in China. And so there's like 50 million people reaching the age of 16 each year in China. And so, you know, 3% of those would be Christian probably. So that's like 1.5 million Christians in China that are taking the mark of the beast that is described in Daniel, or in Revelation chapter 13 rather, literally. And it's all, you know, it's probably directly all, I mean, it is what it is. The same thing with India. They have, and since the one in China was established in 1984, the program began as a voluntary program that has, you know, expanded. Now it's mandatory. And those cards in China have RFID chips with the ability to locate people. So if a riot police, for example, were in a riot, they could scan a crowd with an RFID reader and find out all the people that were in the crowd, because they're required to carry those cards with them at all times in public. Unless, of course, they left them at home, in which case they could just search the people for those people that don't have their cards, I guess. Anyway, the point is, it's a totalitarian mechanism of governance, and it's faithless. And it's receiving a name from the government, and it's submitting to tyranny. And no cowardly person has any part in the kingdom of heaven. So submitting to tyranny is not really something that's an option if you want to have eternal life. So there's that. So, and then, okay, and then in India, they have, since 2009, they began a program to enroll their people that were on welfare in a national identity card program. Well, that program has grown to, they've enrolled about 1.1 billion people in that program. Currently, I think it's voluntary, but they are scanning people's irises and using the retinal scans as a form of identification. So that's your mark in the forehead. So it's a mark, it's a form of identification. And that's what they're doing in India. So between those two programs, you've got 2.1 billion people. 100 billion people a year are taking the mark, because in India it's a 18 million, I'm sorry, 18, year 18 of age, they can enroll in that program. You're going to get 97 out of 100 in India and in China are ignorant. They don't even have a nominal faith in Christ or understanding of Christ. It's the very darkest part of the world in that sense. The rest of the world kind of has some idea of the scriptures. And again, there are 6 billion copies of the scriptures, but not, they're not in India and China. Now, in the rest of the nations, if you have a national identity card, like Mexico has one, and Israel has one, it's a very serious issue. Again, there's no reason to think that those national identity card programs are any less offensive to the Creator God than what they're doing in China or in India. And I read an article a few years ago, basically, that the Bilderbergs were pushing for a global identification card. And again, this is basically just the Antichrist, false prophet, Rothschilds pushing an agenda to number people, to force them into a more controlled economic regime so that they can exploit them, so that they can take the produce of their labors for doing nothing, basically. I mean, basically, all nations on the planet, with a few exceptions, have given the Antichrist, false prophet, Rothschilds control over their monetary systems. So, that would be the image of the beast that is worshipped around the world. And the IMF, which is also Antichrist, false prophet, Rothschild controlled, recently announced that they would be setting up the image of China as a world reserve currency. So that is the image of the beast that rises up out of the earth with two horns, which I think is China and India. And they're setting up as an image for international trade transaction. And that, you know, it's the Antichrist, false prophet, Rothschilds that are doing these things. They set up Israel they helped establish it back in the big turn of the century, the Antichrist, false prophet, Rothschild family. And so you've got this narrative where they've just been bringing all these things to pass that are described in the Bible and inserting them in. And so that, yeah, it is what it is. But my guess would be that 3.5 years of the fourth beast of Daniel chapter 7 and in Revelation chapter 13, that will begin probably around the same time as the fifth trumpet. And it may be that same economic crisis, that 5 months of rioting, and with the locusts, the actual description in the fifth trumpet is of locusts, of riot police. And if you think about it, riot police, they've got the faces of men, right? They've got breastplates. Usually they have some kind of breastplate. They have padded armor, like war horses, because war horses would usually have like a padded cloth armor or leather armor if they were engaged in war. And it says specifically something like war horses, I think. And of course, riot police. Oh, and some of the helmets in a lot of the nations, like China, for example, and Russia, they have gold crests on their insignia on their helmets. So there'd be a golden crown on their heads. But that's, you know, that's fairly common throughout the earth that the riot police have insignia. And of course, riot police, they sting people with non-lethal weapons like batons or tasers or pepper spray or tear gas or water cannons or LRADs. And so for 5 months, there's going to be economic chaos. And it may be that that economic chaos is either war, natural disaster, or it could be, you know, because of the health effects of fallout, people being upset about that. It could be this economic transition from the US dollar to the Chinese currency and from the United States as, you know, the global economic superpower and intellectual superpower to China becoming the global economic intellectual superpower on the planet. And of course, that's a huge difference, right? Because you've got ostensibly the vast majority of people in the United States being Christian, at least in some form or denomination or some knowledge of Christ, to godless, atheist China. You know, the Chinese are run by, you know, communists. They're officially atheists. They're antichrist. They don't believe in Christ. They deny Christ in China. And, you know, it's so bad in China that they're actually forcibly harvesting the organs of people. So they enroll them. First they give them their 6+6+6 equals 18 digit citizen identity number, a number for a citizen on a mark on a national ID card. And then they take enroll them in their healthcare system. They're taking tissue samples, and then they can do tissue match as well. That's a huge, right? When they get that information in a database, someone's willing to pay, you know, $100,000, $200,000, $300,000 for an organ transplant in China, and these people match and they're poor or whatever, they're just harvesting their organs and killing them and taking them in China. They're murdering people something like hundreds of thousands of people, and a lot of them because of their belief systems. So, like, there's the Falun Gong, but there's also Christians, lots of Christians, you know, and anyone can practice Falun Gong and be persecuted. So Christian Falun Gong practitioners, but also just Christians being, you know, practicing their religious beliefs are being oppressed in China. And then, again, they're being forced to take a mark. And a lot of people are like, wow, you know, why is it such a big deal that they have an 18-digit, you know, 6 plus 6 plus 6 equals 18-digit number as a citizen identity number? Well, it's a number for a citizen. You know, a driver's license is a number for a license. A birth certificate number is a number for a birth certificate. It's not a number for the person that's a name. It's the difference between making a product and naming a product and then giving that product to someone, and then making a product, giving, or making a product and then giving it to someone, and then naming the person. It's a big difference what they're doing in China and probably in other nations on the planet. I mean, I haven't gone through exhaustively all these nations and tried to look at, you know, who's screwing up and why are they screwing up. I'm just figuring these things out as I go along too. And it would be nice if there was more people trying to figure these things out rationally. What's God upset about? Why is this an issue? And how do we not irritate him so that we can have eternal life? That type of thing. So we can fit into that society, because you can't have people that are going to screw up that society and that society for millions, billions, trillions of years. And so that's important also to understand. Because God isn't going to torture people for millions, billions, trillions of years. That's ridiculous. And that's people trying to elicit donations, you know, tithes or whatever. And so they say that, oh, God's going to torture people for millions, billions, trillions of years if they don't do what's right. And are you robbing God? And that type of stuff. That's not rational. God doesn't torture anyone for millions, billions, trillions of years. The Lake of Molten Sulfur is a place of cremation. It would be the place of weeping and gnashing of teeth where people will go to be cremated after the resurrection if they grow old and die. Now, keep in mind, Adam lived 930 years on a perfect new earth in a healthy new body. Noah lived 950 years. So it stands to reason after the resurrections, people are going to live for hundreds of years in healthy bodies, even if they don't eat of the tree of life. And so there's going to be a lot of time to meditate on our failings if we're outside. If we're inside, we've got eternity to meditate on our failings. But the point is, go inside. Let's all go inside and taste and see that the Lord is good. And his ways are perfect and right and just. Give him a chance. Give God a chance and go in to the New Jerusalem. Outside are the dogs, you know, the sorcerers. That's like drug use, you know. Drug use is pervasive on the earth. That's like the number one, that's the first thing that God outlines in Revelation chapter 22. Outside are the dogs, the sorcerers. So there's over-the-counter prescription and illegal drugs. There's people drugging other people without their knowledge. And then there's food additives, like caffeine and other drugs. There's thousands of food additives. And, you know, and a lot of people don't know what they do, and they mix with other chemicals, and they're not necessarily tested very thoroughly. And, you know, it's a big mess. It's really a big mess. You know, they're taking nature, and then they're processing it, and then they're making something unnatural. And so, yeah, you know, they could probably take plant fiber and turn it into cardboard, right? I mean, they do that. but do you want to eat cardboard? No. I mean, you could eat cardboard, but why? Why not just eat what the Creator designed? Healthy, natural fruits and vegetables. You know, and oh God, it's just so disgusting. Like, there's recent reports that they were putting arsenic in the food for like chickens. And that would fatten them up so that they would have more meat on them because they were poisoned and their tissue was being damaged. So it compensated by fattening up the chickens. The problem is that's poison and it bioaccumulates. And so it's being passed down the food chain, or up the food chain rather, and it's not good. But it's greed. I mean, it's greed-oriented, it's greed-centric. And the truth is, mankind has the knowledge to grow enough food for everyone on the planet, but it's choosing not to. For the sake of enriching the Antichrist, false prophet, Rothschilds, basically at everyone else's expense, when it comes down to it. And it's greed. And I think mankind is capable of so much more. I mean, wouldn't it be nice to be feeding everyone on the planet when Jesus comes back and say, you know what, Lord, we screwed up on most everything, but at least we figured out how to feed each other. we took what you designed thousands of years ago, and we grew enough food for everyone to eat. We made that a priority. You know, all these streets and all these cities on the earth could be planting fruit trees for people to eat of, but they don't plant fruit trees for the most part. You know, why don't they plant fruit trees on the streets instead of all these other trees that they're planting on the streets, you know? That's public land in most nations. Berry bushes, you know? I mean, there's no reason anyone should be starving to death on the earth in the modern world. Anyway, let alone 7 million people here, holy cow. And, you know, over 100 million people since 9/11. And yet they're spending $6 trillion to deal with the tragedy of 9/11. It's absurd. It doesn't make any sense, folks. It really doesn't. It's completely illogical, irrational. And God's a rational God. You know, he created reality. He's not irrational. So, anyway, best regards. I hope these videos help.